hounds.
We are partying hounds. We are doing it right.
Apple stock had gone up sky high and had, you know, so much money, and I just thought, wow, time for a big, huge concert out in the middle of nowhere, you know? We just go out and we make our own city.
For 300,000 people just getting along, having a good time, no trouble. It's California, it's where it's at.
I think the first I heard of it was from our booking people, you know, from our talent people, and, you know, it was just this sort of vague thing that, Steve Wozniak was planning.
You know, we're out, we're living our own rules this day, and we're enjoying time, and it's you know, it's kind of a great reset of the whole body when that happens.
I just got here about an hour ago from the military. Yeah, definitely party place, definitely.
Memorial Day weekend at the US Festival. All right, rock and roll.
They kept talking about, there's no spirit, it smells like Woodstock. Well, I say, screw them, Woodstock's over, the 60s are finished, and I say, good kidding.
Welcome to the 1983 Up Festival. You're going to have the rock and roll time of your life.
You have to remember that this was at a time when there wasn't 57 festivals going on like there is now. It was years after Woodstock, and while there was the occasional big outdoor show, this was immense.
Let me get my 3D glasses on.
You know, big things happen when people are just sort of camped out, living on their own, meeting new friends. So I wanted more of that aspect of things than just a big concert.
Yes. My recollection of them was that they were phenomenal. That was a really great time for them, really starting to get huge. They were big for us, big MTV act.
Well, you know just why you do it. I mean, the way you move, soft and slippery, cut the knife, razor, rarely talk, that's the
friends here. We wanted to see Joan Baez. Where's Joan? God, we're missing her. Donnie and Marie, where are they? Hey, I'm bummed out. But we're going to make the 3 days even without Donnie and Marie.
Hey, everybody.
How you doing?
We're the Stray Cats. We'll be out in about 5 minutes. See you then.
Oh, man, I couldn't sleep last night.
Yeah, I got some kind of, I got some butterflies, but they're good butterflies, you know.
The Stray Cats, in the beginning of MTV, were one of our big bands in the early days. Back then, they seemed like a novelty act. They were great at what they did, and they were rocking, and they were fun. But I came to realize, and I think that by the time the US Festival was happening, I started to realize, you know what, Brian Setzer is for real with this stuff. He genuinely loves that. That's really who the guy is. And as it turned out, when I left MTV and I moved to LA, by accident, lived down the street from the guy. So I used to see him out walking his dog. I'd be out walking mine, you know. He'd be out there with the same haircut and tattoos all over him. And it was like he walked off stage and onto my street with his dog. So I developed a great sensibility of liking their music.
Your mind, oh, if it just could, well, that's make up your mind.
In the late 70s, there was a little bit of rockabilly that was happening, but it was really the Stray Cats that made it happen. And what the hell, they were huge. I mean, people loved the Stray Cats, so whether the kids at that time realized, hey, wow, this is 50s music, or hey, this is just great rock and roll music, who knows? I guess they must have had a sense that it was sort of a rehash or a reworking of older music, but they dug it. And the attitude, you know, the attitude was exactly the same. Hey, man, I don't feel like going to school no more. Me neither, you know? That's what they were about, and you know, you look at me once, you look at me twice, you look at me again, there's gonna be a fight, you know? Kids love that stuff.
We interrupt this place right here. I said, you guys would interrupt this kind of place right here, right now.
Men at Work for us at MTV were one of our big success stories. They were a band that we loved. And I always felt at the time, and even more so as years went on, that they got the short end of things. They were always regarded as the poor man's Police. They were fantastic live. I think they really kind of showed people. And Colin knows that his eye is weird. He's a great front man. He was always a storyteller and always loved to laugh and have fun. And I think it was even testimony to what a great band they were to be able to pull it off in a situation like the US Festival in front of all of those people. Not everybody can do that. And I think that they did a great job of it.
It's always a tricky thing playing to that many people simply because of the fact that there are so many people that it is a sea of people, so it's difficult to project.
Here's a song you may well know.
I remember with that show, it was just really a matter of trusting that what you were doing was working. The US Festival was at the end of 83, I believe. You know, it's the biggest live show still I've ever played. Because we were on top of the world at that point, so it was almost like we couldn't put a foot wrong. Playing there was the fact that it was the first time that they had crossed to the Soviet Union and they were listening to us play as well, and you could see people dancing in the street and stuff. That was a pretty good thing. I was excited about that.
Who got it? lucky. I felt really like we were where we were supposed to be. I feel lucky to be here now after what I did to myself. People, it kind of doesn't really get much better than that in terms of being in a rock band. It's a dream. Well, I've only got one working eye, so I couldn't take in the whole crowd all at once.
By the time the US Festival happened, the Clash were superstars. I loved the attitude. They were punks. They were superstar punks, which kind of ran counter to what punks were supposed to be. But they tried their best to walk that line. And I respected them for that because it had to be a hell of a hard line to walk. Now, the performance was great.
How many people are interested, remember the US Festival? They write back that they've never been to a concert in their life that was so memorable as that one. Well, that puts it in just, you know, outer space for the people who were there.
People still come up to me and say that they were at the US Festival and it was a great experience. So people seem to remember it quite fondly.
When you assess a decade of music, you do need some distance, and I guess we're far enough out from the 80s that we can kind of look back at it. And a large section of music fans and people who are around today, the 80s are, that's their heart and soul. That's when music was really, really great. And it's comparable, I think, to the 60s. You know, people look back to the 60s as being a pivotal decade. And I think that people look to the 80s, whether right or wrong, as a pivotal decade, or at least a decade that really resonates personally for them. I would say that about it.
The 80s, you know, I have no idea, you know. Who was in the 80s? Who was in the...
Well, 80s...
Get dirty. Get real dirty.
Raise, raise, engage.
Sex, drugs, and rock and roll!
Yeah.
Metal Day turned out to be sheer insanity, as it's supposed to be.
It's hot and the deck crusty, you can't move it.
If there's a problem, take the guy down, subdue him, right? We got enough guys that we can handle any situation.
When I looked down from my room one day and saw, you know, about 300,000 people in the arena we'd built, I was frankly scared.
My name is Floyd Tidwell, Sheriff of San Bernardino County.
What would you say was your most important professional goal in handling an event like this?
To prevent a riot, a major riot.
A little bit of stuff involving the word, the law. You know what I'm talking about, huh? You want to give her the title, Breaking the What? Breaking the What?
It's what a rock concert is supposed to be, especially a festival like that, an outdoor festival. And my hat's off to especially, you know, the first, whatever it was, I want to say 50 rows, but there were no rows. And it was raging hot, and they were being crushed against the front of the fence. And the performances that day were unbelievable. Thank you. Cooperated by, I think it was, it had to be 100 degrees at least. And San Bernardino, for people who don't know, it's just geographically, it's sort of in this bowl, and it was just dust and heat. And, you know, they were hosing down the metalheads down front. It was kind of crazy that day.
So we have to make sure you take care of each other out there. Also, if you could avoid pushing on the front. It's very serious. We don't want anybody getting hurt. We don't want anybody getting crushed. for taking care of you in a lot of other areas. We need you to help take care of yourself. You can do that for us? All right, we're going to do it together. It's going to be one hell of a rock and roll day.
Same old story.
Show you where it's at.
I think it was the highest attended day. I remember hearing that day there was over 500,000 people there, which was incredible. You know, this is 1983. Woodstock was 1969, and that was, you know, that was the last time that there was ever a gathering that huge, and it's pre-Live Aid. So a hell of a big day, and what fans are more active than metal guys?
You owe your best to the people that love you most.
were other groups where I met the people and became close to a few of the performers.
Yeah, I've known him longer than he's known me. Maybe he's known me longer than I've known him. I don't
know.
One
or the other.
I don't know who did the most research.
Did you buy your Apple before I bought my records?
No.
I like this kind of a thing because there's a lot of concentration specifically on the music. You know, there's not a lot of effects. There's not a lot of extracurricular activity necessarily from the stage. It's just the band playing the music, and that's all the people getting. And if you're 9 miles away, you can't really see anything except the, I guess you got the screens here and stuff, but it's most of the music, and I kind of like that.
Shorter and the nights are getting long. Feels like we're running out of
deal for this live hit on Metal Day was I was supposed to bring this band on stage, and again, 500,000 people. Here's little me, I wander out on this gigantic stage, and I do what I'm supposed to do. I'm supposed to rev them up. Hey, I'm Mark Goodman from MTV. What's happening? How you guys doing? Everybody's screaming and yelling. They're throwing stuff. And all right, you know, everybody ready? And we're going to bring these guys out. And it's so fantastic and great. And well, is everybody ready? And I get everybody screaming. Everybody's at the top of their lungs going nuts. And then I get this signal from the side of the stage. No, 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 no. What? What? We were too early for the satellite feed. Oh, but this is live, they're all ready. You know, and I literally had to go, okay, everybody, take two. That's the way it went.